everyone. Can everybody hear me?
Yep.
Back specifically? Cool. So, a little introduction to me. I'm Parker Mathewson. I'm the founder of The Right Sites. Up here at the top, you'll see me and my beautiful girlfriend, Elisa. Together, we have three cats, and if you at all follow Game of Thrones, you might recognize their names, which are Arya, Jon Snow, and Tormund. On the screen are the loves of my life. So, yeah, that's it. A couple years ago, I graduated with a Bachelor's of Science in Computer Science. I found that I really enjoyed coding and algorithms and data structures and continued to make it my career path to go down that route. I'm also the kind of crazy person that really enjoys running. I just finished my first half marathon, and now I'm training for a full marathon. So if anybody else enjoys running, come talk to me after. We can talk about our injuries together. I got my start in web technologies with migrating a couple dozen Joomla websites to Drupal for an academic institute. And with that same position, I worked on a Ruby on Rails application, building a social network for biomedical researchers to share their work and put job positions up. And that's really how I learned that I really had a passion for web technologies. On my free time, when I'm not learning or playing with animals or running, I really like to snowboard. Haven't quite made it out this season, but we're still working on it. Before working with WordPress, I worked at IBM as a software engineer. And in 2017, I kind of started butting heads with them as I started to want to do some side projects as a client came to me and with a migration project that I really wanted to work on. So in 2017, when I wanted to found The Right Sites, I went to the IBM lawyers and asked if I could make money on the side building websites. They said it was a conflict of interest due to working on databases with IBM and WordPress having databases. So I said goodbye to IBM and fully embraced my passion of web technologies. Growing up, my family has always been of the entrepreneurial mind and has invented many products, which has let me have a lot of different experience with physical product shops and the warehouses with that, and seeing how businesses work with selling physical products. So when my first client came to me with this migration, I thought it would be a great opportunity for me to expand into a new platform and really use my experience with physical goods to help build really fun and good stores. I'm really focused on growing with WooCommerce. I follow all of the blogs. I'm getting involved in these meetups a little bit more. I'm really excited for the WooCommerce admin panel upgrade coming in a future version of WooCommerce. I myself, with my company, have been building a whole bunch of reporting tools that are currently they are trying to mimic the look and feel of the current WooCommerce reports to make it seem like you're having the same experience, and looking at redesigning everything for this new WooCommerce admin panels. In 2018, we released our flagship plugins. There is two so far on the WordPress.org directory, and I have four on my website, therightsites.com. Looking forward, I'm continuing to expand my custom solutions through freelance, and hopefully the plugins that I make can be marketable, and hopefully I can get you guys some ideas to help you guys make marketable plugins. So let's get into the meat of it. Migrating an established company. So when you're talking with a client, you know, in the beginning, it's really all about the conversation and making sure that you are nurturing the relationship that you have with this client. You know, when you're first getting started with this migration, you need to know what kind of data consistency they are looking at. Do they have many user accounts that need to be transitioned over? Are they looking for order history to come in? Are there business critical tools that don't necessarily exist on WooCommerce? Are you going to have to build them yourself? Do you need to outsource to another developer? Are they on CodeCanyon? Are they on the WooCommerce marketplace? On just a random third party website? These are all kind of solutions that you kind of need to think about. When creating a store or even when doing a migration, it's great to have a list of needs versus wants. And this is something that can be revisited a lot as you are building your store out and as you are building a store for another client. So some problems that I have run into while coming from especially legacy systems. Clients to me have come to me saying, well, why is WooCommerce, you know, going to be the solution that I should use? You know, they're looking at Shopify, they're looking at Magento sometimes, BigCommerce, and you know, they might say that WooCommerce, you know, it leaves a lot to be desired. But as a lot of people here might know, WooCommerce is built in a way that is extremely extendable and that lets developers come in and add customizations to so much of this great platform of WordPress and WooCommerce. So WooCommerce itself might seem to some clients as if there isn't much there, but with the marketplaces and developers, WooCommerce can do anything. Another big issue that I have run into with some clients is that they want their user experiences to improve, but their users themselves have been resistant to change. One of the larger migrations that I did was on a company that had existed for 16 years before they wanted to switch websites, and this customer or this company, you know, when we flipped the switch inevitably to transition their website, they got calls from customers being like, oh my gosh, I don't know what's happening, it's a new website. I failed to mention that the average age of their customers were over 55, and they just, it was like shell shock to this company. They got a lot of compliments as well, but overall the user experience should improve. With this same company, this company had a well-structured point system, that has existed for 15 years, and these same clients that were calling up being like, hey, I have been your customer for 15 plus years. This point system, you know, they were able to get points from referrals for the 15 years. Essentially giving them free money to spend on this website. When I was migrating this client, it was a big issue that they needed this point system to continue to exist. Now WooCommerce, I don't know if you have seen, if anybody has seen it, WooCommerce and many of the other marketplaces have plenty of point systems. There's a ton out there, and you can choose any which one, and they're great. But this client specifically needed to fit this specific point system. This was a huge issue for me. Making a point system, It's no simple task. You know, that's getting into discounts and getting into the checkout process. And if you make this wrong, it's something that can stop a company from making money. So you need to weigh your options as you are making a decision of this. Of, do we put in the development time to make a new point system? Do we research for how many days to see what kind of point systems are out there? in the end, we solved this problem through four straight days of communication and research with this client to find three different plugins that, when combined together, fixed this. It was no easy task. When your store is being launched as well, you're gonna find a lot of random issues. One of the biggest issues that I found when I first went to WordPress, which, you know, it's easy to slip by, is that I was testing emails. You know, WooCommerce was sending out emails. We were using MailChimp for marketing emails. The password reset link worked for me. But as our traffic started to increase, we found that people were getting locked out of their accounts, and they were just making new accounts. And when we inquired with a customer, they said, oh, we tried to reset our password, nothing happened. So WordPress and PHP specifically have ways of sending out emails through your web host, but that doesn't mean that the email clients are going to accept your emails. So one of the hard first lessons that I learned is that there is a third-party plugin that lets you use third-party email services. There's many plugins that do this. I specifically use WP SMTP. That will let you use another service that is trusted, that is similar to MailChimp, or but it's a little bit more basic, that lets you send emails like password reset through a trusted resource that Gmail will no longer reject, or Hotmail won't reject, or AOL, things like that. So opportunities that can come from migrating. Like I said earlier, you know, it starts with the conversation. You want to take your time to get to know your client. You want to take your time to really poke around their website, ask if you can get access to see how they use their website. If there is any data that WooCommerce doesn't necessarily track that is integral to their company, that they don't necessarily know, that WooCommerce does not track. You know, if it's appropriate, ask them to walk you through like their daily workflow. How are they going to be using WooCommerce and WordPress? Ask probing questions. You know, like questions that have gotten me to decide on better plugins for people is like, what's your highest daily operating cost? What's your lowest? Do you have any hidden costs that you found that in your day-to-day business that you just don't track on your current website? Find ways that you can expand the WooCommerce functionality and make their lives easier. Find out how you can do some light automation through other plugins. You know, a lot of times clients, they will know to poke around in plugin directories, but they don't necessarily know which plugins to trust. Other questions to ask is a lot about reports. You know, we're here for WooCommerce specifically. We're all talking about e-commerce. Something really powerful about e-commerce is reports. WooCommerce has some great, powerful reports built in, but there's still 100 different plugins out there that have reports built in. I have made some. Some of my clients like to look at only table-based reports, which is not necessarily how I like graphs personally, but you know, everybody has their own solutions. Opportunities don't stop at delivery. Continuous communication often brings further improvements. I continue to reach out to my clients after a week, after a month. I get them on the phone, I talk to them, and I ask them about how they are using the products. See if there is ways that that I can help improve their day-to-day life. You know, sometimes you can get some additional plugins, some additional functionality. Sometimes it's you know, they just say it's a great job and they give you a nice review. So that always feels good. At the end of the day, whether you're a developer, designer, store owner, whatever, time is our biggest asset. And time goes quick. It's really the only resource that you really have no control over. You can outsource, you can, you know, hire other people on, you can delegate tasks, but you still only have a limited amount of time during the day. You know, you gotta split your time, whatever you're doing, between clients, customers, research, the new things coming out, learning the things that are already out. You've got to expand your products with design and development. And most importantly, you know, while we might be here for work and or hobbies, we still like to have life outside of our businesses and making money. You know, in the very beginning, I like running and snowboarding and playing with animals. I like to spend time doing those things. So making sure that you have a good support structure around you is extremely important, which is why we're so incredibly lucky that the community is great around us. There's a lot of support in WordPress and WooCommerce, and WordPress and WooCommerce already save us an immense amount of time. You know, like, some people might be able to build an e-commerce platform, but the whole entire CMS that is WordPress, no, that's years and decades in the making, and lots of extremely smart people who have built this. You know, and finding trusted partners and companies who create great products is it's an important tool for us all to leverage in this community. So, honestly, if there is one thing that I would like you guys to take away from all of this, is that communication is key. And honestly, talking to clients, customers, building up your resources around you, it's extremely important. I have severely lacked on it last year. I'm really coming out of my shell this year. I'm trying to go and meet people. So, thanks for listening. If you'd like to reach me, see my contact information up there, or I'll be up here for a while. So, thank you. Does anybody have questions, comments? Got one up in the corner. So the question was, you know, WooCommerce and WordPress are a great structure, as I said earlier, but you know, you start adding plugins and all of a sudden your admin or your front end are getting slow. Like, why is this happening and what's the solution? Well, honestly, it's complicated, and that kind of goes on to the point of finding good plugins and well-designed plugins. There is many plugins out there that are running all the time, no matter what page you're on, no matter what you're doing. And those are just not necessarily well-designed plugins. When you are designing a plugin, you have to actually like tell it where and when to execute, which it's hard to say exactly. Like, there is no number of plugins that is going to make your website slow down. I have a website that has, you know, 50 active plugins, and it's running just fine. It's really about the quality of the plugins. You know, you might have something that is integral, and it might only be slowing the admin panels down, which is, I mean, that might be something that might harm you, but is not necessarily harming your customers. So it's about finding the plugins that are designed well enough that fit your need.
That's the question. I mean, you can toss out.
I mean, so that's kind of one way. Another way, do you have a comment on this?
Well,
So he's, so I mean, oftentimes plugin developers will give you like a month return policy. You know, sometimes you can find out in forums out there. So like, I often build websites for clients, and I use a lot of plugins that I do not develop because I don't have the time to develop, you know, a whole website's worth of plugins. And often, you know, it's going out, trying the plugin, maybe returning it. You can find forums out there that will have people discussing like, oh man, like this specific inventory plugin that I'm using that was free on the WordPress.org directory, wow, it's completely killing my site in terms of admin speed. So sometimes you can find people out there who have gone through it. And I mean, to kind of bring it back, and with all of this, I wouldn't say it's necessarily a crapshoot, but it does take like some checking of a plugin to see how it affects your site, see what other people are saying, and I mean, if it's really important and it comes down to it, you know, you can get somebody to do a code review, whether it's a trusted developer you know or you're contracting it out, and just having a well-versed developer look at the code.
Another thing that's really key is your security of business interest on your website. And the minimum you should be running a free security plugin, a security or defense. But ideally, if you make a ton of money off your website, it's kind of like buying insurance. You should have a small yearly subscription to one of these security companies such that if you do get hacked,
a software firewall is immensely helpful. honestly, I love storefront, and then I develop on top of that. I wouldn't say I use a couple other ones, but I currently have run multiple sites on Astra and storefront. Astra is kind of my more general, if it's not necessarily for e-commerce. It's really powerful, has a lot of customizations that don't even take coding at all. And I really like storefront. It's developed by WooCommerce. I know that it's not gonna have any major security flaws, and if it does, it's gonna get patched. And it's really easy to extend on top of it.
You had mentioned, oh,
sorry. Go ahead.
I haven't done Shopify or Magento. I've done Etsy, and I am currently looking at a client who is thinking of switching off BigCommerce, but that's still, we're still in the talking stage. Most of the stores that I've done have been ASP, Classic, one ASP.NET, and one homegrown Ruby on, or Ruby in Ruby on Rails, and they just didn't know what was happening. So
you had mentioned the new WooCommerce interface. Can you maybe tell us why you're so excited about that?
Yeah. So if anybody is following it at all, you might. Well, the WooCommerce interface that's coming up is, I would honestly equate it to what the block editor changed for WordPress. It changed from a more or less static and PHP submission to where anytime you're doing any major change, you're gonna reload the page, to a JavaScript and user-driven interface. It's going to be changing pretty much everything that you see within WooCommerce in the administration panels, from coupons, products, well, coupons and products are going to come later, but it's starting with reports and the dashboard and how you receive notifications on the WooCommerce section of your website. All of the graphs and things are switching to a more broken out individual smaller graphs with more replaceable components. Honestly, it looks really nice. It's kind of, I would say it might be a little harder on the eyes, but at the same time, it's going to be coming pretty soon here. I don't know if they're planning version 4.0. If anybody knows. Kind of up in the air still. With that, they are also contemplating, well, they are switching how the coupons will be viewed, the reports will be viewed, dashboard. They will be switching how products are stored in the database and how you interact and create products. So those are things to look forward to in the upcoming future.
Or have an
aspect idea. As a developer, yeah, a little bit. Honestly, from a user endpoint, I think it will be a welcome change. I think it will be less stressful than moving to the block editor or Gutenberg. It might take a little bit of getting used to recognizing the reports, but I think you're gonna find more important and valuable information within the reports, and it might even be a little faster. We'll see. So, it's exciting. Any other questions?
So, for managing a WooCommerce site, is there a certain process that you go over, you have a place for like, how many updates? So say you update, like, let's say it's 10 plugins and 4 other things you're updating. Is there a testing procedure that you go over that's really solid and check and make sure the transactions still look good and layouts aren't ready and things like that?
So, the question was is, you know, when you're updating plugins and core on your store, is there any processes that I use specifically or any that I recommend? honestly, there's a great service out there called Robot Ninja. And Robot Ninja explicitly tests WooCommerce and your main functionality of being able to sign in, being able to check out as a signed in user, being able to check out as a guest user, and actually make payments for those. And I think register a user as well. I don't recall right now. Anytime that I'm updating anything that has to do with WooCommerce, I am running that. It's honestly a really affordable solution. As for development, there is a whole testing suite for WooCommerce and continuous integration tools. If you want to get into that more, you can come and talk to me, but it's a little bit more of a complicated thing.
What about like for, like,
yeah, yeah, and with a real payment too, like actual money, and then it refunds it. If you also are, there's another one that I actually learned at the WordCamp recently, which is a Ghost Inspector. It's where you can make your own tests. You run through with your cursor and tell it to click certain elements. So like you can test like, oh, will a coupon work? And you make a coupon code. And you can do a lot more with that if you have a test that you would like to run on. So it actually does it by like div IDs and classes. Yeah, correct. Yeah, it's pretty smart. It doesn't always work on the first try, but if you're used to like inspecting element and actually seeing like the ID tag, like you can really make it do some really awesome things. Anything else? Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Parker. All right, so I feel like we're ending a little bit early, so.
What's that?
Parker mentioned a couple, he has two plugins that he uses, so I want to see. Are you prepared to show us kind of a little bit more? You guys mess around with WooCommerce websites. I know a lot of you are in the market for more plugins, so I want to give Parker an opportunity to demonstrate or show a couple of his plugins. So go ahead and fire away on the browser.
Long hair. I think beginning of 2018. Yeah. It was some long hair. No, it was my choice. So the main plugin that is on the WordPress.org directory is actually so something that you'll notice in WooCommerce is that, you know, it's missing cost of goods and things like that, and there's lots of solutions for this. But something else that for physical goods stores that WooCommerce does not track is right here is the shipping cost. So oftentimes with a lot of the plugins that are available, you know, you might be able to charge the customer a cost of shipping that might come back from like FedEx or USPS or UPS, whatever you're going through, but that isn't necessarily what you're gonna be charged after you have packaged and shipped and weighed and put it on the truck and everything. So I have created this plugin that will let you, if you're using ShipStation specifically, and a couple other things are in the works, like stamps, but this will let you edit the shipping cost separate from what you have charged to the customer. And I have created some reports that reflect this shipping cost, as well as show you your actual net profit compared to some of the other plugins. So this is the current view of how these reports look. We've got a whole bunch of different lines here that are showing profit, very, very similar to how the original WooCommerce reports look, as you'll see. Really trying to make it really seamless. I also have a table view for customers who like a little bit more of a table view. And like I said, this one is getting updated, revamped to more of what the newer things, the newer WooCommerce admin will look like. Another one of the plugins that I've created is right here. It's so this is actually showing your new customers on a given day versus your returning customers. So here the blue is new customer sales versus returning customer sales, and the respective profit that you're making from each group on those sales, including like coupons, cost of shipping, cost of goods, you know, all the things that you should subtract out of revenue. I also have another one that allows you to add an image to a coupon that lets you display it on the front page. So this would be your actual coupon, what it looks like, which is clickable on the front end and applies a coupon to your cart if it's possible. That's a new one that's not actually fully released yet, but so. Comments on the reports? Questions?
What are your plugins called?
So the one that deals with cost of shipping is on the WordPress.org directory as WooCommerce cost of shipping. This one is called WooCommerce Net Profit. This is not a free plugin. This is found on therightsites.com. So for a single license, it's $79 a month, or $79 a year, sorry, not a month. the customer types is also another paid one, also found on therightsites.com. Net profit, so it's WooCommerce net profit. If anybody's interested in the customer one, it's customer reporting for WooCommerce. Yeah, both the actual reporting ones are on my website.
Do you have an example of the user one?
So again, I was basing it off of the pre-existing. So this is customers versus guests. This site doesn't have guest checkouts. But this one right here actually is the blue's new customers on a given day versus returning customers. The other report has if customers have signed up, but not if they have purchased and they don't split anything out. So I thought that was a decent improvement for an additional report. And actually, if you have net profit enabled, you can actually click on a given day and it will pull up those orders from here on that same table view from the net profit tab. Net profit has to have, or should have, a cost of goods and has to have cost of shipping enabled. And the net profit plugin will already handles and integrates with the cost of goods plugin on the WooCommerce marketplace. If anybody's using that, that one's pretty widely used from my experience. If anybody is interested, I do have a sandbox website that you can log in and play around with the reports. So.